John, I wanted to start off with Ulster's distinguished and very lengthy history now. When you start to think about a new studio album, do you have in your mind what people are expecting from it and what you're expecting from it?
I'm sure that there, on some subconscious level, there's things that stick from talking to the fans, you know, during any given album cycle, but really, no. I mean, and the biggest, I really just try to channel the music in a very natural way, and whatever decision might be made in this instance, you know, the only contrived decision was I don't want to make it a theme or a concept album. We have, you know, we have a lot of those. I just wanted to make it because I had a lot of different ideas for songs, and I just wanted to make it a collection of 10 individual songs that lyrically aren't related at all. And it wasn't even the number 10 at the time, but I just, you know, I knew specific subject matter, and so that's what I did. Just, you know, we rolled with that.
Is it very much you are the band, or you are the leader, and everyone else fits into the way you see things? Or do you sit down as a group and say, how are we going to approach this?
No, I mean, I am the leader of the band. It is. Right. I'm the driving force of the band since the very beginning. That does not mean that I don't take in the input of the guys on anything, you know what I mean? But as far as starting a cycle, and I'm the chief songwriter, so it's kind of what I did. Like, for instance, on this one, I talked to Stu and said, hey, you got to give me some lyrical themes of where you want to go, titles, subject matter, whatever, because it's my job to create the soundscape of
right.
that. And I knew where I was going to go with the direction on the songs I was going to write lyrically. And so, you know, he sent me some titles, and then whatever resonates with me, I've got to be inspired by it in order to create that landscape that really is sort of like the soundtrack of a movie. It's very, very important. And then, you know, I'll get up, the other guys will send me riff ideas, and if it's fitting in and if it's a cool part, maybe it, like Luke wrote the majority of one song called Defiance on this record. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it depends on the song and what the parts are doing. You know, if they're inspiring me and I run with it and go somewhere else or whatever, it can happen in all different ways. But definitely, it starts here and I drive it the whole way through.
So, what inspires you to write a song? Are there particular subjects that are very close to your heart?
Oh yeah, I mean, I would say just for some reason there's a lot of human tragedy that inspires me, you know what I mean? So whether it be
Battle of Fredericksburg, for instance,
yeah,
which is on this album,
that's
inspired
right.
one song.
Yeah, that's really focused more on the Irish Brigade at that battle rather than the battle itself. There was just such a brutal sacrifice and a tragic, very human story in that. And so, I mean, that's a little bit different than Gettysburg, which was really a huge... It got into specific parts of the battle over 3 days,
yeah.
and that was a lot more historical, I guess. This is really, I think, Clear the Way is more of an emotional song, in a sense, and it's a tribute. So, but there are different. I mean, I've written about everything from, you know, I mean, usually the undertone of all of the Ulster stuff, if you look at it, is think for yourself, be your own leader. You know, I just try to inspire people to think outside of the box, which I think is what heavy metal is anyway. You know, it's very rebellious in the nature of the music.
Has to be.
Of course.
It's always underground.
That's right.
And slightly apart from the norm.
Mm-hmm.
You've been described over the years as so many different power metal and thrash and so forth, but in reality, really, you are a metal band.
Absolutely. I agree 100%. That's what I tell everybody. We are metal. I mean, we define metal as far as I'm concerned, because it's not... I don't like all the pigeonholing of particular styles, and Iced Earth has... it's a roller coaster ride of emotions. You know, we cover all the spectrums of heavy music, and to me, heavy is, what does it do to you emotionally? It's not about being detuned and bleh, you know, that's not necessarily heavy, and sometimes I think it's actually very cheesy. It's about how can you move somebody to tears, to complete rage, to whatever. That's heavy, man.
And I think over the years you've certainly proven the point with records that are varied. It's not as if you can sit down and say Ulster Earth go in a very linear direction. You've taken inspirations all over the place.
Sure.
So what do you listen to musically, apart from the obvious, the Sabbath and so forth? Are there any particular musical inspirations that would surprise people?
At this point, I don't know how much would surprise people, but I mean, I'm a big Pink Floyd fan, huge Roger Waters fan. As a writer, he's in, you know, Steve Harris and him are like up in the very, very top of my guys that I look up to they inspire me, you know. So that might shock people a little bit, although I think the deep Iced Earth fans would know that I'm a Floyd fan. I also get into there's a fairly new artist called the White Buffalo. You know, it's like a country type of thing.
Yeah.
But it's really edgy and kind of dark lyrics, and he's sort of a heavy version of a modern Johnny Cash. And I think that guy's awesome. You know, so I'm a big fan of that. And so that may shock people a little bit, but the influences started way back. You know, and that's the Sabbath and Alice Cooper and Maiden and Priest and Kiss and all that stuff.
Do you remember the first music you ever heard?
I can't pinpoint a song, but no. I certainly remember the first Black Sabbath album. My older sister was into that kind of stuff, and I mean, I was like 3 years old hearing that, so you know, that was, and looking at that cover going but being drawn in. So I've been into metal my whole life, as far back as I can remember. I remember when Alice Cooper was on the Midnight Special, and I may have been 4 or 5 years old at this point, and I'm looking around the couch, you know, at the TV, and seeing this crazy show, and was like scared but couldn't stop watching, you know.
Yeah.
And so I mean, it drew me in at a very early age, and you know, it's, I don't know, man, it just speaks to me.
It's really interesting. So many musicians of your generation, when you talk about Black Sabbath or the first interest in metal, a lot of people say, my older sister got me into it.
Oh, yeah?
I mean, considering the fact that metal is regarded as being only the male preserve, and that's it, it's remarkable that it seems in America, for people, as I said, of your generation, older sisters are quite important.
I didn't realize that, but that's cool. I mean, you know, she was into all kinds of stuff, you know, and one of the cool things was my mom worked for RCA at the time, and not the label, but because there was somehow a connection there, it was the plant that made TVs in Indianapolis, but somehow because there was a connection, we were able to get free records through one of the record clubs.
Excellent.
So we'd look at a list and get stacks of vinyl for free. Now, we couldn't get Kiss because Casablanca wasn't part of that.
Yeah, that's true.
But, you know, we did spend the money on that. But anyway, so I mean, a lot of that stuff came in, and Jennifer was into, she was into Zeppelin and I mean, all of, just whatever really was out back then. A lot of 70s rock and just what's now considered classic rock. It's all, we listened to all that stuff growing up.
When did you want to become a musician, actually playing a band?
That was in 1979 when I saw Kiss the first time. Yeah, that was definitely, the decision was made, and it took me a few years to convince my father to give me a guitar, but I did finally, and so yeah.
Did you ever actually stand in front of the mirror, put makeup on, and prepare?
Oh yeah. Yeah, sure. I mean, I was a Kiss member every year for Halloween for years, man.
Which member of the band were you?
It was either Ace or Gene.
Right.
Depending on, I mean, Ace is certainly the reason that I started playing guitar. I think it was the Gene, the dark side that always attracted me to him, you know, and I think it's funny with those guys how they, you can almost look at their personalities and see how they influenced certain genres of heavy metal. Paul Stanley, you know, certainly had a lot to do with the glam rock, you know, that a lot of the guys went in that direction. And you look at a lot of the Gene fans and they went to the really heavy side of things.
Yeah.
But what a group. I mean, they influenced so many people.
Oh, in so many different ways.
Oh, yeah. It's amazing.
So did you put together a band before Iced Earth, or is Iced Earth very much your first real band?
It is my first band. It was just called Purgatory at the time.
Right.
Because and that changed because there was a band from Cleveland, Ohio that got an indie record deal first, and I was actually going through a record store flipping through vinyl, and I see it, and I'm like, fuck! And so, yeah, but it ended up, I think it's, Iced Earth is a much better name. It was a name that my best friend when we were kids came up with.
Oh, right. So that goes back a long way then.
Well, when we were dreaming, you know, like we were pretty much Beavis and Butthead when we were growing up. So we would get stoned and drink and stuff in grade school and skip school and listen to Van Halen and AC/DC and what, you know, whatever was around, Sabbath, and just dream of talking about, you know, talking about starting a band, but you know, we were really, really young kids, and so I just, it's
stuck.
Yeah,
it's a good name to use.
Yeah.
When you actually started the band, did you have any ambitions, or was it just a case of, you know what, we're just going to have fun for a couple of years?
No, it was definitely a mission.
Right.
Yeah, it always has been, you know, and I always get asked what drives it, and I don't know. Sometimes it's the passion of creating songs.
You drive it.
Yeah, but what drives me, it's that desire to write songs that move people and that have an effect. And I never was chasing the money, and I don't really care about the rock star bullshit. Mm. That's shallow to me. I really look at like a product at the end of like what starts here and in the heart and soul, and then we go through the process, we make it, we get it done, and then the awesome thing is seeing the effect that it has on the people. And you know, when you look out in the audience and you see people crying their eyes out because of a song like Watching Over Me or whatever, and you're like, man, and then you hear all these stories of how it's helped people through some, you know, really tragic stuff in their life. I mean, that's gratifying. That's worth it.
It must feel like actually you're making a difference in a good way.
Yeah, sure.
Which a lot of people think, oh, heavy metal is just sort of, it's negative, it's Satanist, and it's...
Yeah. But that's ignorance.
Well, exactly. It's total ignorance. And you prove it time and again with what you write about on the album. For instance, the opening track on this album, The Great Heathen Army, is very much a Viking-oriented thing, isn't it?
Yes, it is. That was Stu's lyrics and his idea. And I mean, we're into that stuff, but he's definitely in Norse mythology a lot more than I am. And when he said that was one of the things, the directions he wanted to go in, I was like, yeah, I can get behind that. So when I put together the intro thing, I really was very confident early that was going to be the opener of the record, and then the whole thing just flowed.
You actually played that live on your last tour, didn't you?
We did, yeah.
Did it change because of people's reaction to it? The fact you did live with the song for so long?
No, not at all. We had just wrapped up pre-production. Everything was running behind because of the building of the headquarters building, and then it took a little longer than we wanted, so that delayed the writing and pre-production and everything a few months, and so we got a little off track. But by the time that Headbangers Ball tour happened, the pre-production demos were done.
Right, done.
So all the arrangements and everything was done. We knew basically that tour happens, we go home for a little like a week or 10 days for Christmas break, and then come back and start master tracking the record, and then very little changed after that.
So you're a band who basically pre-production sets the whole tone, and nothing really changes once you're in the studio doing it properly.
Yeah, for the most part. There's always little ideas that'll come in, or maybe the biggest changes that I make may be an arrangement change, which I do in editing later. But yeah, I have to do really detailed pre-production demos because we live all over the planet, and it's not like we can just get together and jam on the weekend or whatever, you know. So that makes it difficult. So I have to really, and I prefer to do that because I would rather spend the time getting all the details right and then going in and owning the performance,
right,
you know, in a master tracking scenario. But everybody knows what they're doing at that point. You know, that's preferably the way that I like to work.
You have a new lineup of this album as well, don't you? Mm-hmm. You've got a returning drummer,
yep,
and a new guitar. So what happened there? Why the changes?
Well, Troy, who was at the band for 10 years, he had some personal issues that he had to deal with. His son's autistic, and his support system was not there that he had for a long time. So going away for, you know, any length of time was
difficult,
really stressing him out. And so, you know, he came and talked to me, and it's sad. We love Troy, and he's always going to be a brother. I mean, we're in touch with each other almost every day on text and stuff, and he lives really close to me, but... it just became a situation for him that was too much to handle, actually. And family comes first. So,
yeah, fair enough.
You know, Jake came into it. We had held auditions on Dropbox, you know what I mean, with video auditions.
Right.
Hundreds of guys, actually, from all over the world tried out and sent me stuff. And so I started looking through it, and I got down to probably six guys that I got on the phone with and had long talks with. I had met Jake because he was in a band that opened up for us in 2011 in Europe. It was called White Wizard.
Oh, that's cool.
And he played for those guys, and the phone conversation was really great. I mean, we spent a long time on the phone. At one point, after he sent me more stuff, I was asking for more things from him. And I said, okay, let's do the in-person thing, fly out here, and it went great. So.
And that was it, right. So at what point did he join? Were you already well into pre-production for the
album? Yes, we were. It was done.
Right.
So it was too late for Jake to contribute like songwriting ideas, but he's got great ideas, so I very much look forward to working with him next time. Yeah, you know, that was because it was a shame actually. One of the last things I had him send me was, I said, I've heard some of your stuff. It's amazing, and he does like the prog metal stuff, and he's very talented. I said, but you know what Iced Earth is about. So send me stuff that if you were in the band and you were going to submit riffs, let me hear what you got. He sent me a couple, and he sent me some stuff, and I was like, shit, I wish we had time. You know, I was thinking that I wish we had time to develop those ideas now, but we didn't. We were too far along.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, but we will.
And Brent Smedley's back.
Yep.
For his fourth stint, isn't it?
Yeah, it could be.
So what happened there?
Well, you know, it's the thing is, in a band like Iced Earth, in a mid-level battle, which is what it is all the time, it's tough. It's a lot of hard work, and people have lives, and sometimes they... stuff happens in their lives and they have to step out. Brent's always, he's always been a brother, and he's always been a big part of the band, and he's just had varying times in his life, things go on where he's had to step out, and so I had a fill-in guy last time, and then he's back now.
Permanently? Well, fingers crossed, permanently.
I hope so, but you know, it's the permanent is a hard thing to say about anything in life.
Yeah,
you know
what I mean? As far as you're concerned,
that's the idea. Yeah.
That he's back for a long stint this time.
Yeah.
And you yourself, of course, have had your own health problems.
Yes.
How much did that impinge on working on the record?
Well, it didn't, actually. It would have, had I ignored the problem, I probably wouldn't even be able to play guitar anymore.
Mm.
So, I mean, it got to that point where the first set of treatment, the doctor in Germany that bought me probably 4 months of time by having a specific therapy done down in Germany, I mean, over in Germany, but in the southern part. I was reading Tony Iommi's book on tour in Eastern Europe, and I was starting to like lose control of my right hand. I mean, my picking hand would go into the patterns, and my brain's giving the signals, and it wasn't happening. So I was getting freaked out, and so
I'm not surprised,
you know. So I was happened to be reading Iommi's book, and then I got in touch with management and said, find this doctor. We're going to be in Germany. I need to see him. And they did 10 injections every day. I was on a train every morning going to the clinic from whatever part of Germany we were in. 10 injections in the neck and elbow and wrist. And he did that every day. And it really, I felt a lot better almost immediately. And then got about 4 months, maybe 5 months of touring. And then it started to crash. And they did an MRI then in Germany. He said, you got to have surgery soon because this is dangerous. You one wrong move and you could end up paralyzing yourself. So it was pretty bad.
Yeah.
And the pain was getting really ridiculous, and just the fact that, you know, and I know this is the second time it's happened. So I mean, this was actually a lot worse than the first, back in 2000 when I had the first surgery. So, you know, had I pushed it, who knows what would have happened. But, and then also it took time to heal up from this, and then I got the buildings and built the headquarters there, and then it got the, you know, really a place to where we can focus, and the guys love it there too. It's a very cool vibe for us.
So, the headquarters basically is Iced Earth's home, as it were.
Yeah, that's right.
Studio in there as well.
Yeah, right. Yeah, it's the office, warehouse, studio,
everything, and
the living area. Whenever they're around, the guys are around, and I live there. And at the moment, and you know, it'll be one of those things. I may not live there forever, but it's going to be our place for, you know, I'm going to do all my musical stuff there.
Iced Earth Museum maybe opening at some point?
No. Well, not as far as, not, I mean, that maybe when I'm dead, but not, yeah.
Well, a long time in the future, hopefully.
Hope so.
So, presumably, you recorded the new album at that studio.
Yes. Yeah.
Did you actually decide yourself what equipment you wanted in there, how you wanted it set up?
Well, I have a lot of equipment. I've had it, you know. Especially when it comes to a lot of different guitars and amplifiers to get different tones. But I have a really nice setup, actually. But as far as the acoustic treatments, Jim Morris helped me with that. I basically sent him a diagram of the shape of the rooms, and he said, "Here's what you should try to do with the walls." And so I got a few people's input on the soundproofing and controlling the sound, and you know, going at that different ways, and then there's still some of the stuff on the album that's from pre-production that Jim had his hands on some of the engineering. I did some of the engineering. A guy named Chris Harris did Zeus. Mm. And then he mixed it at his place. Right. My place is not a mix studio. There may come a point where we get the control room really dialed in for that. But he's got a great setup there, and he did an amazing job on it. So, and then he mastered it as well.
How long did you spend in the studio recording?
Well, that's the thing. If you look at what was master tracking, 20 days.
That's, you know, quite quick.
Yeah, it's very quick. But that's because I was super prepared.
Yes,
and there
course.
Was a lot of the stuff that I kept from the pre-production work. You know, there was certain vocal parts that we just got with Stu right there. So I was like, dude, we're not going to beat this. I mean, why would we? Yeah. Why spend time? Why did we do it? I mean, it's killer what it is. So there was some of that with the guitar parts. You know, quite a bit of the rhythm guitar parts I recorded by myself, or I did it early in the morning before the rest of the guys got up. And so that kind of, I'm very efficient. You know, I'm working my ass off when we go, and that's part of being prepared. But the months that it takes to do the pre-production, that's where the time is. That's where you're really investing where I'm investing the time, because typically it's me working by myself. And that's, you know, can be, depending on how the writing's going, 3-4 months, maybe more, but that's kind of the typical way it works.
Of course, the beauty of having your own studio is you can go in any time you want.
Exactly. That's the idea. And, you know, it's making those pre-production situations more relaxed, and not like saying, okay, we have the calendars. We got this tour going on, these festivals, and then we got this. So you have a 3-month window. You have to make a record, and that can work, but it can also lead to being pushed into just doing something because you're on a time schedule. And I'm never going to repeat that again. There's no point. We've had to do that a few times in the past, and I've reached a point in my career where I know it's not a wise move. We're going to get a better product and a better end result if we let things flow naturally. And everything can be there's always a point in production when I get to a certain point where I can confidently say to management, okay, you can start booking at this time period, because I know we're going to be able to achieve that. But I'm just not ever going to be pushed into that again.
No, good idea. Have control.
Yeah.
At what point do you decide what the album is going to be called? Is that right at the end? Oh, what are we going to call it? Or do you have an idea all the way along?
It's happened different ways through the years. Sometimes it is all the way along, and sometimes it actually helps frame the overall.
Especially when you vision. Go to a concert or a theme.
Yeah, right? Yeah. But then with this one, I had a working title, and it became kind of. I'm trying to remember when I came up with the idea of calling it Incorruptible. I think it may have been around the time that we were headlining the Bangerhead Festival, which would have been last summer, I guess. And I was over there because that's when I started getting the image in my head of the artwork and how I wanted Set to be, and to have this, you know, like he's being crucified, but to have this really defiant fuck you grin on his face, because that's a kind of we've reached that point, you know what I mean? This album is a milestone in the career of the band. We've finished our contract. We'll never deal with the old world slavery of the recording business again. You know, it's a new day for the band. And through all of the shit and all of the hardships, the vision has remained completely incorruptible, and that's a fact. And anybody that has followed the band through the history, they know that's not going to happen. So it's a true dedication to heavy metal, and this is a, you know, it's a milestone record, and it's going to be interesting to see what comes next, because we have many options. And even though a lot of people are afraid of a collapsing business, the old way is certainly collapsing. I actually see it as a opportunity, a lot of opportunities for the artists for a change.
Yeah, which is nice.
Yes, you know, absolutely.
You mentioned you had the vision in your head of the way you wanted the artwork to look. So when you sit down with the artist, do you actually say to him, this is what I want? Or do you leave to some extent open for the artist to interpret it his way?
Well, I always say this is what I want, but then of course they're going to put their feelings in, and then their interpretation of that into it, and then we go back and forth until it's dialed in to where I'm happy with it. Some it depends on which group of artists, or because usually with Iced Earth there's at least two.
Yeah.
Because when we do the comic book style, graphic novel style art, you almost always have a penciler and an inker, and then you. maybe one. Sometimes there's three guys. You may have a penciler, an inker, and a colorist.
Right.
Sometimes the penciler and the inker can be one and the same, and so it just depends on the situation and what you're going for. But yeah, I mean, I'm involved with every part of that, because that's all part of the vision that I'm always chasing and going on in my head. It's not just the, you know, I don't just come up with guitar riffs. I do a lot more than that in the band. And so it's like the whole, it's kind of the whole thing in the, to the end package that people are holding in their hands, you know, with the kind of a layout and the push for doing some kind of a cool package that, you know, I mean, I remember, and this is a little bit of it, it's really different, but every time I'd get a Kiss record, there was something cool in there. There was a poster, there was the Love Gun thing or whatever. When you're a kid, you think, wow, that's badass. We aren't doing that, but the idea is that we're giving people cool things to look at, cool images. I started that with Horror Show. Every song had a piece of artwork, and I think I pioneered it because nobody else was doing that before.
No, I think you're right.
And now a lot of people are, but on this album, we've taken it to a whole new level. I mean, the artwork is it's spectacular. All 10 panels for the 10 songs, probably 7 of them could be album covers themselves. So it's which is also setting a precedent I hope we can keep up with, you know. But that was the dedication of the art team, also being one of the penciler was my is my tattoo artist and a very good friend. And then this guy Roy Young, who did all the color illustrations, he's been a fan of the band for 20 years. He was actually one of the guys that colored the Dark Saga cover.
Oh.
He was working for Todd McFarlane then, and I'm pretty sure it was him and Todd Broker that did the colors. But you know, he worked for Marvel Comics and Chaos Comics and whatever, and we got reconnected when we played in Phoenix on the Plagues of Babylon tour. So that was great. It's great to have him on board. He did this unbelievable work.
Well, one final question, and that is, where would you say this album sits in terms of the Iced Earth catalog? Obviously it's the 12 studio album, but are there particular moments in your career you look at as being those are the really major moments when we move forward, and is this part of that, do you think?
I think it really is one of those. I mean, I feel like it's going to be a classic Iced Earth record, but I also know the fans decide that. And I wish I had the formula to say that if we knew a classic, how we were going to make the classic record, they all would be, you know. Sometimes things just, everything lines up right and the it works, and I feel like this is one of those moments. But I think that more importantly, it's kind of a new birth of the band, and it showcases somehow you can feel all of the errors of Iced Earth in this one record. I think it's got all the dynamic, and that wasn't even intentional, but that's the way it came out. So that's I'm really happy about it, and I hope, you know, I can't wait to hear what the people think.
I think they'll love it.
I hope so.